So tonight we are going to be viewing a few films by Kenneth Anger. It's in conjunction with our Summer of Love exhibition, Lavender-Tinted Glasses, curated by Joey Cain. It's up until the 17th of September. So there's still some time. This is the second program in the series in conjunction with the exhibition. So we talked last month about Janis Joplin and one of her lesbian lovers. This month's kind of Anger. Next month we're going to be doing an event on Gavin Arthur and the Circle of Sex on the 14th of September. Yep. Okay. Thank you.
Well, thank you all for coming out tonight. What I intend to do is talk a little bit about Crowley's influence on Kenneth Anger and show three of Anger's films. Are there any Kenneth Anger legal representatives here tonight? Good. We have lovely Blu-ray versions of his films. How many people are familiar with Anger and his films? Good. So yeah, okay. Well, this is a chance to see, you know, his films once again. You can never see them too many times. So I'll be starting out, actually, we're going to do a bit of a moment of silence for Heather Heyer, the woman who was killed by the neo-Nazis and the fascists. I'm then going to do something that's called a banishing ritual. It's sort of to, like, get us in the mood for what's coming. I'll then do a little introduction to Kenneth Anger's film Firework from 1947. Then I'm going to do a little introduction, and this is where we talk a little more about Crowley, his mythology, his magical system and stuff, and its influence on Anger, and then we'll show inauguration of the Pleasure Dome. And finally, after that, because this is about the Summer of Love, and it's featured in the exhibition, we're going to show Invocation of My Demon Brother, which was filmed here in San Francisco in 1967, although it didn't come out in 67. And I've got my friend Philip Zimmerman here, who's done a lot of research on the event that the film was, a lot of the film work was done at, which was an equinox of the gods. It was the fall equinox in 1967. It was done over at the Straight Theater on 8th Street, and Philip has a lot of information on that. And then we'll show Invocation of My Demon Brother. So that's the order. So to start, I'd just like to take a moment and just close your eyes and just like to do a moment of silence for Heather Heyer and the folks who have been really injured fighting the fascists and the neo-Nazis in Charlotte.
Agala. Around me flames the pentagrams, and in the column stands the six-rayed star, Ate Malkuth Vegadula Vegabora Leola Maum.
And the circle is cast. So, Kenneth Anger. Kenneth Anger, much to his disappointment, was born in 1927, as opposed to 1930, which is what Kenneth has maintained for most of his life. Like any good queen, he's shaved off a few years of his from his age. He made a number of films as a child. He's very precocious. He managed to take the family little 8mm camera, which was used to record family moments and family vacations, and subvert it into making his films. And in that way, Anger, as a filmmaker, as a poetic filmmaker, sort of staked his future. His films are some of the great works of poetic filmmaking. The first film that really broke through, came to public attention, was a film called Fireworks, which will be seen tonight. And I won't really talk much about it. I'm not going to talk a whole lot about the films, because Anger's films really are constructed to work on your conscious and your unconscious. And I don't want to burden people with too many preconceptions. Fireworks did, however, bring him to the attention of the great poet, writer, and filmmaker Jean Cocteau over in Paris. And as a result of Fireworks, Anger went over to Paris at, I believe, Cocteau's invitation, and spent about 10 years over there, studying with Cocteau, having a fabulous time in Europe, and developing his film language and his film technique. Again, Anger always promulgated the myth that he made this film when he was 17. Appears he was closer to 19 or 20, but when you see the film, it's a brilliant film of a very precocious and accomplished filmmaker at the age of 19. So, without further ado, let me see if we can do what we need to do to make this work. Our magic wands.
Yeah.
And then I do, let's see, what do I do? Do I do the pop-up video? Oh, wait.
In Fireworks are released all the explosive pyrotechnics of a dream. The inflammable desires dampened by day under the cold water of consciousness are ignited at night by the libertarian matches of sleep and burst forth in showers of shimmering incandescence. These imaginary displays provide a temporary release. Thank you.
Thank you.
easily inventing new queer cinema 50 years before it officially began. This film, without a doubt, is probably one of the most important homosexual films ever made.
What year is it?
1947.
Oh.
Here in the United States. It has influenced many, many people. I won't go into too much analysis about it, but it was one of the first time you had a filmmaker self-identifying as gay, because that is Anger in it, and entering into his dream worlds, his fantasies, and creating an incredible work of film poetry. So because of this, Anger did travel over to France, and at Cocteau's invitation, and worked a bit with Cocteau, and also became very close with, and I believe lived with, and I'll probably get this wrong, Henri Lebois, who was the head of the Cinéma Français, one of the great early cinema archives and an official place for studying it. And he actually worked at the Cinémathèque and had a chance to see all sorts of film. Anger had a great love of silent film. He loved the image. An early influence on him, and this is not unusual for many gay boys, he had a grandmother who sort of nurtured his love of film, his world of fantasy. She actually, I'm not quite sure she was a lesbian, but she lived with another woman. And this other woman worked in a costume department at one of the major studios. And so his grandmother and this woman sort of fed his young gay boy desires, fantasies, images, and he claims, although there's no absolute proof of it, that he played the changeling prince in the Max Reinhardt production of A Midsummer Night's Dream. Now, if you see the film, it really looks like a young Kenneth Anger. But one of the great things about Kenneth as an artist, he has his life is a mythopoetic work. So sometimes one doesn't argue about what's fact and what's not. But if you're a historian, you do want to know what the facts are. And Anger can be a little opaque when it comes to finding out the actual facts. So he spent time in France, and he also was coming back to the US. And at some point, right around probably when he was still in high school, he seems to have been introduced to the ideas of Aleister Crowley. We believe he was given a copy of Crowley's biography by Curtis Harrington, who is again became another interesting experimental and horror filmmaker here in the United States. He was very close friends with Anger from early on. One thing I wanted to mention before I move on to the next section. A photographer by the name of Chester Kessler helped Anger with the photography on this film, and we actually have Chester Kessler's, one of his original photographs of Anger from 1967 in the exhibit. So if you haven't seen the exhibit, check that out. Kessler himself is an interesting person to eventually I'll get into researching him. He seems to have focused a lot on dancers. There's a collection of his work at the San Francisco Performing Arts Library and Center, I think it's called. He photographed people like Anna Halpern and other folks, dancers like that. But to come back to Anger and Aleister Crowley. So he certainly was familiar with Crowley. He read Crowley's biography. And he became, one could say, a devotee. There seems to be some evidence that he was familiar with Crowley's organizations. Let me go back and fill in a little on Crowley. So for those of you who don't know, Aleister Crowley was a poet, a ceremonial magician, a philosopher, a writer, and a mountain climber, amongst other things. He was also considered the most wicked man in the world. A title which he relished. Crowley had a great sense of theater, he had a great sense of humor, and he also was a very serious philosopher and student of world religions. He really was, he was probably initiated into a couple of different systems, Buddhist and various others, but his main thrust was studying Western ceremonial magic. When he was about in his late teens, early 20s, he became involved with the Golden Dawn, which was an order of magicians. People like Yeats were involved in that. A number of other poets and artists were involved in the Golden Dawn. Crowley rapidly sort of assimilated all of their teachings. He became close with one of the founders. He became, again, he was precocious too. And he eventually had a falling out with the Golden Dawn. He went and set up his own system, sort of stealing their rituals and working them over a little bit. So he became a practicing magician, probably the most famous ceremonial magician, probably in history. Part of his magical system had to do with sort of disordering the senses in order to reach deeper levels of consciousness. From an early age, some of his major relationships were with men. Crowley's probably one of the great bisexuals of the 19th and 20th century. While he was still at college, he became involved with a man named Charles Jerome Pollard, who was one of the most famous theatrical female impersonators of that age. It was the late 1890s. Jerome Pollard was a dancer, a great dancer who performed as a woman, and at the end of the dance, when everybody's blown away, he pulls off the wig, which is a very wide theatrical style in the late 1800s. Crowley becomes involved with Golden Dawn, studies their system of magic, sets up his own magical order, and by around the 1910s, 1950s, he starts to really experiment more with sex magic, and he reorganizes something called the Ordo Templi Orientis, which is a pseudo-Masonic organization, but that sort of had a special, its secret teaching was about sex magic. And he reorganizes it and makes it his own organization. Around 1910 or so, Crowley became involved with one of his longest term relationships with a man named Victor Newberg. And they were together about 5 years. Newberg is probably most famous, well, he's famous for two things, being Aleister Crowley's boyfriend for a long period of time, and discovering the poet, the great stuff. Do not get general into that, the poet. Well, it'll come back to you. I'll let you know later.
Dylan Thomas,
yeah. Thank you. He was one of the first people to publish Dylan Thomas. Victor Newberg and Crowley were involved in a number of sexual rituals. One was the Paris working, as it was called. They also did a trek through North Africa, through Morocco and Tangiers in that area, through the desert, with Crowley performing this very elaborate ritual that took weeks. With Newberg, and it produced a working called The Vision and the Voice, which is actually available as a book now. So Crowley developed this magical system, and I just wanted to read Crowley's definition of magic. I personally, having studied ceremonial magic and been involved with the OTO and stuff, I've looked at a lot of different people's writings on magic. Crowley really attempted to approach it from a scientific basis. He published a journal whose theme was the aim of religion, the method of science. And in his book, Magic and Theory and Practice, he defines magic simply as the science of, and art of causing change to occur in conformity with will. Any change, any required change may be effected by the application of the proper kind and degree of force in the proper manner through the proper medium to the proper subject. This seems really simple. And it is. This is sort of the basis of what magic is, specifically Crowley's form, but really all forms. Crowley developed his own system. He had students. He taught students. He initiated people. He set up his own order. And along with the magical working, and the goal of the magical working was what he called the knowledge and conversation of a holy guardian angel. He purposely chose one of the most archaic, bizarre collection of words to describe what we would call, you know, what the higher self, contacting, connecting with the higher self, understanding oneself on the deepest level, understanding one's true will, and that is, it takes work, it takes practice. Psychology is something that's come out of this. Jungian psychology has come out of this. This pursuit, the use of images, the going into the unconscious. Whether you call it holy guardian angel, extraterrestrials, the higher self, it is the deliberate and explicit exploration of that part of ourselves. In 1904, while he was in Egypt with his wife, Crowley received something which he considered his great, the great revelation that he received. He called it simply the Book of Law. It was a transmission, again, from Awas, an Egyptian entity, from extraterrestrials, however you picture it. It was a transmission that he received. He actually heard a voice speaking, and he wrote it down, his wife wrote down some of it, and it became the basis of Crowley's religion, for lack of a better word, called Thelema. The little cards that you had on your chairs in various colors is something called Liber Oz, and it's sort of the religion of Thelema in a nutshell. The core of it is the maxim, do what thou wilt, shall be the whole of the law, love is the law, love under will. And then it goes from there. You know, it requires one to seriously pursue to understand what one's true will is. And it's not necessarily what your parents taught you, what your schools taught you, what the army taught you. It is learning to strip away all that stuff that's been placed upon you and finding out who you are on the deepest level. So this religion of Thelema has some deities that Crowley was attracted to. One is the list of deities here. Well, there is, at the basis, there is the deity of Hadi, Anui, and Ra or Kuit. This is sort of a kind of a classic trinity. You could think of it as the patriarchy, the matriarchy, and what comes afterwards. You could think of it as thesis, antithesis, and what's the thing after?
Synthesis.
Thank you. And it was very important to Crowley. Through the Book of the Law, Crowley believed that this was the law of the new aeon. And this is where we get into the Dawn of Aquarius. Crowley felt that this was the law, this was the word that would bring on the new aeon. Now the new aeon, or the dawn of the age of Aquarius, wasn't something that was going to happen in a few weeks or a summer. It was a larger thousand year transition. And he conceived, he saw it as there'd been an age of matriarchy. It was an age of patriarchy, and we were moving into the new age, which he conceived of as the crowned and conquering child, the Horus, the age of Horus, the child, the unencumbered child. A lot of Anger's imagery, especially in this next film, you'll see he's using some of the Crowley ideas and Crowley deities. I was actually having a conversation with my friend Will here. We were talking about Native American prophecy. And we came to understand all prophecy is about the world is going to end and then it's going to get better. Mm-hmm. That's sort of almost across all religions. And in a way, this fits into that pattern that we were talking about. To connect it to what went on in the 60s, Crowley did become, especially here in San Francisco, there was a huge Crowley revival coming out of 67. There was a, we had Anger living here in San Francisco. Oh wait, I'm skipping ahead of myself. We'll save that for later. We'll go back. So, Anger is under the influence of Crowley, or influenced by him. And some of Crowley's deities are Osiris, the Great Beast, the Whore of Babylon, and as I said, Horus. So our next film, sorry I'm a little disjointed, I've been up since 7 this morning working and stuff. The next film. In about 1953-54, Anger attended a party down in L.A., and the theme of the party was Come As Your Madness. Well, he went to the party, and he noticed most of the people who were there were dressed up as gods and goddesses. And the party apparently included folks like Anise Nin, other sort of L.A. bohemian literary and cultural types. Anger thought, oh, these are great costumes. I could make a movie around this. So using some of the people who attended that party, borrowing the house of a friend of his by the name of Samson Debris, who is one, I won't even get into him. He's a really fascinating gay man down in LA. He had this lovely house, although it's smaller than one would think, where each room was sort of done as a different period. And she was a very high queen, very high. And so Anger borrowed Debray's house to film over a period, a number of weekends, our next film, The Inauguration of the Pleasure Dome. He had folks come in their costumes. He created a couple more costumes. And I won't tell you what it's about, because I'm not absolutely sure. The film should really be sort of just enjoyed. Don't be too worried about what it's about. It is fabulous imagery, great use of color. I might add, under Crowley's system, there is, not unlike the symbolist poets, but colors mean things. Certain symbols mean things, multiple colors. And so what you have is, in constructing this film, Anger is using this huge vocabulary, huge language, with almost everything, from color to the angle of the shot to the way people are holding their hands to the way they move, the poses. This all comes again from ceremonial magic out of Western Kabbalah. And Anger is employing all of this to affect the subconscious. The theory being that colors and all of these symbols and that affect us on an unconscious level. Whether or not you accept that, that's fine, but that's what he was. That was the area that he was working in, the mentality he was working in. So I just want to name a few of the deities, so just when you see it, you have some ideas. So we've got Shiva, Osiris, Nero, not really a deity, but Cagliostro, who was another great magician from an earlier period of time, the Great Beast, 666, the Scarlet Woman, Aunt Kali, Aphrodite, Isis, Lilith, Astarte, who is actually in the film played by Anise Nin, Caesar the Sleepwalker. Now, this is an unusual deity, right? This is from the cabinet of Dr. Caligari. Like I said, Anger was very influenced by German expressionist film, but by silent film. So he actually has Caesar, the sleepwalker from the cabinet of Dr. Caligari, in the film as a character. And in the film, the character is actually played by the filmmaker Curtis Harrington, those of you who are familiar with him. Hecate, which is actually a female deity who's played by Kenneth Anger in the film. Pan and Ganymede. So those are the characters that are going on in the film. I'll say one more thing about the film. I know there's a lot. In 1966, there was a movie theater here in San Francisco on Kearney Street, a small movie theater, I don't know the name of it, which apparently Anger, I read in certain film journals, lived above the theater. But in the theater, they did a program specifically for people to come and take acid to watch certain films. This was one of the films. And you will see why. I'm trying to find out more about this theater. I know who owned it and stuff like that. But over on Kearney Street. So this is one of the films that absolutely influenced the Summer of Love and the people who were here.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Considers actually finished. So he's tweaking, adding new frames, new music. When I first saw this film in the 70s, the soundtrack, by the way, fabulous, right? Janacek, I can never pronounce it right, Golgotha Mass. Anger does his visual images and then puts the music in. For this film, he said that he had this piece of music in mind while he was in it. However, in the 70s, when I first saw it, he had this other version of it where he had the ELO, Electric Light Orchestra, seriously, Duraldo, I think?
El Dorado,
thank you. Believe it or not, it worked really well. So, but this is, again, you can't find a copy of that version. He's also added stuff, so his work is sort of always a work in progress. So 1954, he finally ends up here in San Francisco. 1966, he's living here, as I said, in above the movie theater, where they're showing this film to audiences hot and out of acid. And he, in around early 67, I think maybe, moves into a house over on Alamo Square that's known as the Russian Embassy. If you've been over to Alamo Square, it's the one that's on the corner that has the Widow's Walk up on top. I think that is at Baker and Fulton, I think. It's not down with a pretty postcard. It's on the other side.
Fulton and Scott. It's at the Russian embassy. It's Fulton and Scott.
Fulton and Scott, right, the Russian embassy. And it got the name Russian Embassy because it was headquarters for Russian emigres who had fled Russia during the revolution. So, white Russians, not red Russians.
Uh-huh. Any idea of the age of Anger? Was he a 50s person or the 30s, 40s?
In terms of when he was born,
yeah,
or in terms of
his birthday?
Oh, he was born in 1927.
Wow.
1920, and he's still alive. He's 80 years old this year.
Very nice.
90. Oh my God, is that right?
Yes.
Oh, it is 90.
Where does he live?
He's down in LA, and we checked, trying to bring him up here. It's $25,000, which is not going to be a lot. Let me just finish, and then I'll do questions. I have to get this out before. So he's in San Francisco, 1967. So he moves into the Russian embassy, as it's called, and he is working on a work which he's working on for a long time. Ostensibly, it's eventually titled Lucifer Rising, and it's his, again, using the mythology, the idea of the changing of the aeons, the child Horus, all of that. He's looking for a Lucifer, and who's not? He eventually hooks up with a man named Bobby Beausoleil, and he does a bit of filming with Beausoleil, and they're kind of, who knows, again, the great mythology. Were they boyfriends? Was he straight? Was Anger madly in love with them? Whatever. They both have different stories. But anyways, they're living together over in the Russian embassy. And if you look at the exhibit, you'll see a photo of a house with Beausoleil standing in front of it with his top hat on and Do What Thou Wilt written in red on the door in front of the front door to the house. Anger is continuing to film. He's putting together he's shooting all this film. Actually, are people familiar with a poet named Lenore Cantrell?
Kendell,
thank you. She's in one of the films. She, of course, was a major figure in 1967, a little earlier with a famous book she put out that was charged with obscenity. She will be in our next film. So will Bobby Beausoleil. Anger is working on this film, pursuing magic. One thing I forgot to mention is he's been longtime friends with Anton LaVey, the great founder of the Church of Satan. We think they knew each other even down in LA. They go back pretty far. You'll also see LaVey in the upcoming film. So he hooks up with Bobby Beausoleil. Beausoleil is a musician. Beausoleil forms a band called the Magic Powerhouse of Oz, which is actually derived from this Liber Oz, but also a reference, of course, to Wizard of Oz. Anger is pretty smitten with him. Beausoleil is, I think, performs a few times with his band. He was actually in an earlier band called Love down in LA that I think actually had a hit or two at some point earlier. Anyways, they plan a major ritual working for the equinox in 1967, the fall equinox, to be done at the Straight Theater, which had been the Hate Theater, and it was the theater that was sort of taken over by the community. It was where the Grateful Dead performed, the Turkish Snare playing. It was a local neighborhood ballroom and music space and other community. So they planned this major ritual multimedia event for the night of the equinox. They've got I think three bands playing. There's a poster in the exhibit, thanks to Philip, that is actually a poster for this event. You can see on this where the Mind Troupe was involved. So it was a huge, The Charlatans. Thank you. Yeah, the sentence to rhyme with the Charlatans. So it's going to be this major multimedia event, which is again to work an act of magic intentionally to transform people's consciousness through the use of music, through the use of ritual, through the use of chanting, through the use of colors. And at this event, supposedly, Anger showed the print he had of his film Lucifer Rising, what he had done up to that point. We've got music going, we've got lights. Anger is also performing a ritual. Not unlike me walking around here doing, although he's way better dressed and it's much more like, you know, theatrical out there, and he's performing a ritual. Now, some people say that night he took way too much LSD and was out of his mind, was sort of like going off. But everybody there was on LSD. So it's very hard to get very accurate descriptions of what happened that night. Supposedly, just before the ritual started, I believe he and Bosley kind of broke up. That night, after the ritual, after the performance and everything, Bosley is supposed to have stolen the film canisters, the only print of this work, Lucifer Rising, that Anger's been working on. He supposedly steals it, goes off. Beausoleil ends up down in LA and hooks up with the Charlie Manson family and is supposedly the film, the myth is, the film canisters were buried on Spa Ranch down in LA. Beausoleil eventually is convicted of murdering the musician Gary Hinman on Manson's orders and is now still in prison, serving a life sentence on that. Eventually, Kenneth and Beausoleil make up, and originally for what event, the film we're about to see, Anger has always claimed, were the editing that was left on the floor. It wasn't the final film, but it was the stuff that he edited out and threw in the garbage can. So he's able to put it together and create the next film we're about to see.
Wow.
Whether or not that's true, we're not so sure, but it's a good mythology. Whether or not Beausoleil claims he didn't steal the film, he said what he stole was he had done a soundtrack for the film, and he claims he just stole the tapes of his music because he wanted his soul and his music back from Anger. Let's see. Philip, do you have anything you want to add? Philip really has done a lot of research on this night. Did I miss anything? Did I miss anything? Okay, great. So the film we're about to see is allegedly, mythologically, edited together from the bits and pieces that weren't in the original film.
Does this have the Jimmy Page soundtrack and the Bobby Boothe soundtrack?
Okay, so what we're about to see is the Invocation of My Demon Brother. The movie you're thinking of is Lucifer Rising, which originally Jimmy Page did a soundtrack for, but the film is 40 minutes long and Page only did 20 minutes, and Anger says he couldn't get, because of Page's busy schedule with Led Zeppelin, couldn't get him to finish the music. So we have Bobby Beausoleil, and this is what they made up. He had Beausoleil, while in prison, Beausoleil formed a band, and they then recorded a soundtrack for Lucifer Rising, which we're not showing. But if you buy the DVD, this all comes with it. So tonight, the next film we're about to see, however, does have a soundtrack by Mick Jagger, using a Moog synthesizer. It's just Jagger on a Moog synthesizer.
There are also fragments of the performance on A Street that are cut in with the leftovers from the first Lucifer Rising. So it's an amalgamation of the two.
Exactly. So what you're going to see is a lot, actually, from when we watched it, a lot of it, someone was there that night working with Anger while Anger's running around, whatever, on acid doing his ritual. Someone filmed the whole event. So a lot of what you'll see in this next one is the actual that night, 1967, the equinox on Haight Street. A lot of it is also filmed in the Russian embassy with Lenore Kandel. and Bobby Beausoleil and some other folks. And then, I don't know if there's much else besides those components to it. So whether or not it really was the remains of Lucifer Rising that Beausoleil stole, that's again part of the mythology that Kenneth has spun as an artist about his life.
Russian Embassy is on Green Street?
No, the Russian Embassy is over on Fulton and Scott.
Oh, okay.
Up on Alamo Square.
Okay. I think the cult still owns the lease.
What was that?
I think there is a cult right now.
No, actually, the person who owns it is a friend of mine, Jimmy Siegel, who owns Distractions over on 8th Street. And Jimmy is a longtime, preservationist, Victorian preservationist, and he's owned the house now for about 20 years. So the house is still there, but not a cult. Actually, there's a film that's come out about the house recently. I don't know if it's been distributed yet.
Not distributed yet.
It's not. Is it available at all?
No.
It's not.
But you can help out funding the project.
Oh, well, would you like to tell us how we can do that? Because I'm fascinated by the film. I've looked on the website.
No, it's still being made.
It's still being made. Okay. Great. Well, and what website? Where can you go to help donate?
Is there a GoFundMe? There is. I don't work for them anymore.
Oh, you don't?
Okay. But that's why I don't have the site memorized, but it's the Western Fund Mansion.
Right.
So if you look that up, you'll find the GoFundMe.
That is. And yeah, Westerfell Mansion. And if you don't remember that, look at the exhibit. There's a photo of the Westerfell House, the Russian Embassy, from much earlier, maybe, I don't know, the 20s or 30s. So you remember the name by looking there. I think that's about it. This is a short film.
Before we move on, could you mention Marjorie Cameron?
Oh, thank you. Thank you, of course. That was a total overlook. I actually met her when she was an older woman. The really striking figure with the red hair and the lashes was an artist by the name of Marjorie Cameron. She was a visual artist, she was a painter, she was a major figure in the occult organization, the Ordo Templi Orientis, which, I'll give you another interesting bit, but let me finish this one. I get so easily distracted. So in the 40s, there was a person involved with the OTO, a major person by the name of Jack Parsons. There's a couple books out about him now. He worked for the Jet Propulsion Laboratories. And he and Cameron were married, I believe, or they were lovers. They lived together. Jack Parsons, there's an L. Ron Hubbard connection.
Oh, God.
I won't even go into it, ask me afterwards. But Parsons and Cameron were partners, lovers. Maybe, I don't think they were married. And he eventually accidentally blew himself up in his garage. And now there's a crater on the moon named after him.
There's a movie about him coming out.
There's a movie about him coming out. There's two books out about Jack Parsons and his connection with OTR and the occult stuff. Now, another interesting bit of gay history is, in 1936, Harry Hay, the founder of the modern gay movement, the founder of the Mattachine Society, played organ for the Ordo Templi Orientis' weekly thing called the Gnostic Mass. And he had known a woman who had been, actually had studied with Crowley off in Sicily, a woman named Jane Wolfe, who Harry always said, she was a raging bull dyke. So 1936, it's Bohemia, 1936, it's the Depression. Everybody sort of knew each other. So Harry, who was on the way to becoming a communist, but he was really, he was a poet, he was an artist, he was friends with John Cage before anyone knew who Cage was. Harry, friends with Jane Wolfe, Jane says, we do this mass on Sunday, we need a new organist for it. So Harry says, oh, I'll come and play the organ. So, Harry was involved at the OTO, not a member, but he was the organist for the OTO.
I think that was in Pasadena, right?
The Jack Parsons was in Pasadena. The 1936 iteration was actually in LA. with a man named Wilfred Smith and a whole other group of people. But that's where Jack Parsons and those folks came from. But anyway, so that's Marjorie Cameron. She has been really rediscovered as an important American woman artist, as a painter. So you can actually do a Google search, you can find out about her. I think there's a podcast or a book
coming.
Wormwood Star, which is Curtis Harrington, who we saw in this movie as Cesar, the somnambulist. Okay, anything else? Any other questions? Any other comments before we...
I was at a radical fairy gathering in Los Angeles Central Forest with Harry A.
Oh, honey, I was probably there too.
You were there?
Yeah.
I
was
there. I want to hear your meeting with Matt Marjorie Cameron.
Oh, well, so I was involved at the OTO, and it was just I had gone down to LA, and she was at some event, and I literally just met her. I mean, I didn't really know much about her. Mm-hmm. We knew that she had been involved. I mean, you know, it was like, oh yeah, that's Marjorie. She was involved with Jack Parsons, but I knew nothing about. I mean, this was in the 70s.
Oh.
Yeah. This is really before her rediscovery. It's late 70s, early 80s. I think it was late 70s. And you know, it was at that point she was being, you know, promoted as, yeah, she was Jack Parsons' wife or whatever. But she was still doing, you know, magical work, but she was apparently doing her paintings and other stuff at that point. But sadly, I didn't know anything about that. So I literally just, you know, shook hands with her. That was not it. At a party. Yeah. Uh-huh.
That movie theater you mentioned on Kearney Street, was that bring your own ghost, or was it with the tickets? For
I would like to find out more about it.
I mean, the audience weren't being dosed. Unwittingly, they were taking it.
Oh no, they were doing it intentionally.
Oh, wait a minute. That was the other question I had. Did that have anything to do with the Cockettes?
No.
No,
this is all very pre-Cockettes.
Oh, okay.
Cockettes don't come until after 67. Mm. And this has been one of the things people have said, oh, you're doing an exhibit on, you know, the Summer of Love or the Cockettes in it. I very specifically stopped in 67. Mm-hmm. And I focused on four queer people who were very important to the Summer of Love, Anger, Ginsberg, Janis Joplin, and a man named Gavin Arthur, who I'll be talking about next month. Because once you go past 67, 68, everything, there's so much. There's just a lot of stuff going on besides gay liberation coming down the road. So I really kept it to 67. Now there are people who were involved with the Cockettes who were around then. And I've been wanting to try to work that in, but this next film, unlike the last one, which is a bit more lyrical, this next one is very jarring. And it really is a almost like very disorienting experience. You have Mick Jagger doing this move soundtrack, and it's very quick editing and very almost chaotic in a way. We don't. Do you have anything you want to add to that?
Yes.
I'm doing okay?
All right.
all right. Invocation of my demon brother, and then I'll make a few remarks afterwards, and if people have questions.
Thank you.
vestige of the Haight-Ashbury, or as his war movie. He said, you know, the Vietnam War was going on at the time. That's it's very intense, very concentrated, very multi-detailed, and like a multifaceted jewel. So.
How can you call that a soundtrack? It's a three monotone note, constant, annoying.
Darling.
It's annoying.
It's still music.
Beautiful.
It's a soundtrack. It is a soundtrack.
Do I have the story right that Anger told Marianne Faithfull about the Bulgakov novel Master and Marguerite, and that she told Mick Jagger, and that influenced Sympathy for the Devil? Have you heard that story?
That could be. I've heard, I don't know the exact details, but I know that, I love that novel, and I think I have heard that it somehow influenced Sympathy for the Devil as well. Anger went from being here in San Francisco, actually after the alleged print of Lucifer Rising disappeared, Anger went into whatever, deep depression. Yeah, and he actually took out an ad, was it in Variety? In the Village Voice, saying Kenneth Anger is dead, you know, with his years and stuff. And he allegedly burnt some films that were like the only prints, da da da. But then he got over it. And he came back and continued to make films. A couple more queer connections of Anger and Lala. Anger was also very, very good friends and very really influenced by Alfred Kinsey. He met Kinsey fairly early on, I think just after Fireworks, and Kinsey interviewed Anger for his study, the study of human sexuality in the male, the great groundbreaking book. That came out in the early 50s, late 40s. No, late 40s. It came out in 48, I think.
He actually sent him notes, very much the same way that Sam Stewart did.
Sent him notes, right. Yeah. And Anger, at one point, I'm not sure exactly when, I think it was in the late 50s, maybe early 60s, actually in his enthusiasm for Crowley and his pursuit of the Crowley thing, actually went over to Sicily, where in the teens, 20s, Crowley had an abbey where he trained people and stuff. And Anger went and got permission from the landlord, because the building was sort of abandoned. It's up on this hill. Actually, there's a big giant stadium next to it now. But and Anger painstakingly removed the whitewash that had been painted over all of the paintings Crowley did in this place. And while he was doing that, Kinsey came and visited him there, because Kinsey was touring through Europe. Anger supposedly filmed all of the walls and stuff. There's only one print of that film in the Kinsey Institute, is the story I've heard. Anger, after his San Francisco period, ends up in London, where he is involved with Mick Jagger and is friends with those folks. Jagger, I think, was funding him for a while. Eventually, he also hooks up with Sir Paul Getty, who was a great patron of the arts, and Getty actually funded a number of his later films. Anger goes on to make quite a few more films. His famous one is Scorpio Rising, which you probably most of you know. It's now credited with sort of being the forerunner of MTV. It was this use of pop music in a film context. Only for Anger, it was always about the visual image and the music himself. Again, he's still alive. Lucifer Rising did finally come out around 1980, I think it was. It showed actually at the Castro Theater. Anger came into town for it. Anger used to come fairly often. San Francisco was a big town for him. And there were at least two showings of his films at the Castro Theater that would almost usually sell out. But again, he's 90. Is that what we figured out? Yeah.
What year did he move to London?
Oh, right around 68. So in Invocation of My Demon Brother, you see a shot of Jagger
performing. He's actually performing at Hyde Park, the concert that they did when Brian Jones died. So that's there's all of these connections.
Uh-huh. Was this film pre or post Altamont? It was pre Altamont, right?
It's No, it wasn't released till after Altamont. It's filmed pre-Altamont, right, because it's going on in 67.
I figured since the Hell's Angel and then the Jagger did the soundtrack and, yeah.
Right, yeah. So it's, but, I mean, let's face it, it's such a precursor, or it seems to capture what happened at the end of 67 into 68. The hate was sort of plunged into this hideous speed epidemic where it became a nightmare. It was really dangerous, and you have Altamont, and in a way, this film really feels like that end of that period of time.
Actually, one of the stars in this imitation by Kenneth Anger, the guy that Lenora Kandel hands the reefer off to, is Sweet William, and he negotiated for the Hell's Angels to be the security at Altamont later. It has a lot of historical resonance running through that film for lots of reasons.
Two questions. One is, I've heard something to the effect that Anger was in Washington at the passing of the Pentagon.
He was there.
When Bobby Beausoleil took the films? Is that when that happened?
No. Supposedly, Beausoleil took the films the night of the Straight Theater performance, the night of the Equinox. But yes, later on, Anger did go to Washington when there was the attempt to levitate the Pentagon.
Right.
As were many other people.
And there's always been sort of talk that Anger cursed Beausoleil.
Yeah.
And that's perhaps how Beausoleil became involved with Charles Manson.
Yeah, sure. My guess is Anger probably cursed a lot of people. He's got this weird reputation of, being difficult. Again, I also did meet him and had him over at my house, and he was totally charming and lovely. But again,
I wasn't his boyfriend,
and I wasn't, we spent a pleasant afternoon and evening chatting about Crowley, and he actually autographed my Hollywood Babylon, which I love because he, to regards from an alumni of wicked old Babylon town, referring to San Francisco.
What year was he at your 501?
81. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Yeah.
In 67, Chester Anderson printed a lot of diggers, handbills, manifestos, Lenore Kandel's poetry. Was there a connection with Kenneth Anger, too? Would
I haven't found one yet, but, everybody was probably, everybody sort of knew each other. I'm trying to find out, there's evidence, Anger did take out an ad in the Oracle, which we've got a copy of in the exhibit here. So, I've been trying to find other Anger connections to other folks in that period. Because there's a biography of Anger that's out, but it's an unauthorized biography. There wasn't much in there about him connecting with other folks. There's also, if you're interested in, at least in the, because these films, these fabulous prints. I mean, I was just watching this tonight. I was like, oh my God, this is a great print. It's the British Film Institute. This is actually, it's a Blu-ray, so the films will play anywhere, but there's two other DVDs that come with this set that are PAL, so they're the British European format. So if you've got a universal player, you can get them. There's this fairly long 70-minute documentary that someone made where they're interviewing Anger, and it's him talking about his life, and it's actually pretty informative. Not all of the details, they don't go into, too much. He does talk about Beausoleil. He's very dodgy about what the relationship is.
Two other comments about San Francisco and Anger. One, his film Fireworks was seized in San Francisco in the 60s, in the early 60s.
Now, was that fireworks or was that, I think that may have been Scorpio Rising.
Might have been Scorpio.
Because there was a famous court case about Scorpio Rising that actually opened the way for liberalizing of what could be presented in film. It actually paved the way for the rise of the porno industry, which was in Anger's intent, but he was always fighting. He really believes in the absolute freedom of the artist to express themselves, you know. That, and then that's where he's, you know, where he was attracted to Crowley's ideas.
You know, chaos will do what it
chaos
does.
Will do.
Yeah. And the other thing is that the connection with LaVey, before Purges Knacked, when he declared the satanic ritual or satanic church, they did a thing called the Magic Circle on California Street, I'm working on an article for October.
Got it. Okay.
And they would address things like vampires and the tarot and on a weekly basis.
A discussion group.
A study group. Yeah.
Right. Over on California Street?
And where LaVey lived.
Where LaVey lived. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Cool.
Oh, about what year did they do that?
It was 66. Mm-hmm. And I think for a while before 66, but I know definitely 66.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we know that. Yeah, if Anger was involved, it would have been 66, 67.
Because it was on Purges Knacked of 66 that they created the Church of Satan.
Got it.
That LaVey.
So there wouldn't have been a connection between Jane Mansfield, because it's a LaVey connection. So she probably could have met Anger, I would assume, right? Or I don't know.
Well, we can speculate. Yes. So let me think if there's any other. Oh, one other thing I wanted to point out. Again, this is the Crowley. I'm a big fan of Crowley, and I look at the queer. I've been working on a book on homosexuality and stuff like that. Interestingly enough, one of the founders of the Gay Liberation Front down in Los Angeles, a guy named Lee Heflin, eventually moved up here to San Francisco and set up a thing called Level Press, which was one of the early presses reprinting Crowley material and stuff. He also he contacted his own Holy Guardian Angel and had his own little book of the law that he published here in San Francisco. And so that was just another interesting connection between the people and Crowley and all of that.
And
so, Lee Heflin was one of the co-founders with Don Phil Hefner and a few other people. The Gay Liberation Front in L.A.
So about what year did you move to San Francisco?
It must have been 1970, 71. I would say 71 or so. Any other questions? You done? Well, thank you all for coming.